So welcome back. We are going to start a fresh chapter, that is second order circuit in electrical science. And this chapter is going to be very interesting. So what is second order circuit, or the other name for this is the RLC circuit. So we have been studying the first order circuit, and in the first order circuit, if you remember, we were dealing with the RL circuit and the RC circuit. So second order circuit are basically the RLC circuit. So first order circuit, which contains only one energy storage element, that is either the inductor or the capacitor, and it is combined with other passive network, that is combination of the resistance. And these passive network partly determine the time taken by either the capacitor or the inductor to charge or discharge. If you remember, we have been discussing the time constant tau, and I said that 5 time constant is the time where the circuit will be entirely charged or entirely discharged. The differential equation that is resulting from the analysis of the first order circuit was basically the first order. If you have RL combination or RC combination, the differential equation that we are going to get is only the first order. Now, today's topic, which we're going to discuss, is the second order circuit. It will have two storage element, means the combination of LC of different type, that is inductor and capacitor, or the same type can be there, provided the elements of the same type cannot be represented by an equivalent single element. For example, if you have two inductor L1 and L2, they are present in such a manner that you can add both to obtain L equivalent, then in that case, I will not treat these L1 and L2 to be a second order circuit. It will be a first order circuit because I can find the equivalent inductance of that. The result is a second order differential equation. So here we were having the differential equation of the first order. Now I am having the differential equation for the second order for any voltage or current of interest. So voltage and current are my variables that I need to determine from the second order differential equation. We will now need two initial conditions. If you remember, in the first order circuit, one initial condition was sufficient, but since it is a second order circuit, we will require two initial conditions to solve each differential equation that is resulting from the second order circuit. Now, these type of circuit, which is the second order, are generally used in a wide variety of applications. For example, oscillators, filters, automobile suspension system, temperature controllers, etc. So wide number of applications are there in electrical engineering where we require the second order circuit. So order of a circuit is basically the order of the differential equation that is describing that circuit. And the order is being governed by the number of independent energy storage element, that is the capacitor or inductor, which are present in the circuit. Now the capacitor and inductor should be independent and should not be combined together to form an equivalent inductance or capacitance. For example, in series and parallel, it might. Now let us see some circuit which govern the RLC circuit and tells the circuit to be a second order. So here in this circuit, we can see that resistor, inductor and capacitor are all are in series with a source. So since two energy storage element are there, we can say the circuit is a second order circuit. Here you have a current source in parallel with RLC combination. Here you can see that two inductors are there, L1 and L2. There is no capacitor in this network. So it is not always necessary that you should have LC combination. You can have inductor also, capacitor also, to make a second order. So here you see two inductors are there, L1 and L2, which is making the circuit to be second order, because I can't add this L1 and L2 together to make it equivalent inductance. Similarly, here you can see two capacitors are there, which will result in the second order circuit. Now, in mechanical system, you might have studied the spring mass damper system, or if you can study this in control system. So these electrical system and mechanical system are analogous to each other. So mechanical analogous of electrical RLC circuit is basically the mass, spring and damper system, where X, the displacement in mechanical system, is basically the voltage or the current variable that we need to determine. The applied force is the input So here you can have a voltage input or the current in. So the RLC network, that is the second order circuit, is analogous to mass spring damper system in mechanical system. Now, as I said that in the second order, it's very important that you find the constant, that is the boundary condition. So it is very important to understand the initial and the final values or the conditions to find the constant. So make a note this, unless otherwise stated, whenever we say the voltage, it simply means the capacitor voltage. When we say the current, it simply means the inductor current. So this is a general assumption. Now, the initial and the final values that are required to obtain the constant in the differential equation are basically obtained from the voltage and the current. So V of 0 indicate the voltage at the initial condition, where 0 means, we have been discussing this, 0 means that switching instant. So it can be some other time also. I of 0 means the current at the initial condition. There are two differential terms, dV by dt and dI by dt, at the 0 condition. If you remember the first order circuit when we were discussed, we were not having dV by dt or dI by dt term. Now for the second order, we will be having dV by dt or dI by dt term, and the initial condition is required to found the boundary condition. Similarly, the final values, which is given by infinity, I of infinity and voltage of infinity, they are basically indicating the final values which are required to solve the boundary condition. Now, it should be noted that carefully handle the polarity of the voltage across the capacitor and the inductor current as per passive sign convention. So in the first lecture only, we were discussing the passive sign convention, that if you have any element and the current is entering it, then it will be positive and the current which is leaving it will become negative. So this is the passive sign convention. So the voltage will be from positive to negative, we can write it. So this is the passive sign convention. And in the second order circuit, as we have to deal with the voltage and the current, so the polarity will play a very important role. Also, when we studied the fundamentals of capacitor and inductor, we have discussed that capacitor voltage do not allow a sudden change. Capacitor do not allow a sudden change in the voltage, and inductor do not allow a sudden change in the current. So they are continuous process. Means before the switching and after the switching, the voltage will remain constant in the capacitor. Before the switching and after the switching, the current remains constant in the inductor, assuming the switching has taken place at t equal to 0. If the switching is taking place at some other time, you could have given t some other time. Okay. We will take one problem to understand the initial condition and final condition. This is the circuit which we are going to take. The switch has been closed for a long time and open at t equal to 0. So where is the switch? Switch is here. Okay. Now, the switch was closed for a long time. So when the switch is closed for a long time, all part of the circuit will be there. And when the switch will be open, then the current that is flowing through 2 ohm resistor will vanish, because you will not have any current because it is open circuit. Now all the initial conditions we have to obtain in this problem. Why we have started from the initial condition? We have started from the initial condition because we have to find the boundary constants, that is A1 and A2, in the differential equation. So first we study the initial condition and then we'll move to the real second order circuit. So let us see how to find that. So let us redraw the circuit for time t 0 minus, the circuit for time t 0 plus, and the circuit for time t equal to infinity, that is the final value. So at time t 0 minus, when the switching has not taken place, or the switch before the instant of switching, the inductor is short circuited because it is long time has taken place. So inductor will be short circuited, and the capacitor will be open circuited because we are taking a time from minus infinity to a time 0 minus, which is a very long time has undergone. So the inductor is short circuited and the capacitor is open circuited. Now this is the circuit at time t equal to 0 minus. Time t 0 plus, what is happening? The switch has opened now. So the resistor in the network is not required because it is an open circuit. and we will be having the 4 ohm resistor, inductor and capacitor, which is basically a second order circuit in the picture. Now the final value at infinity time. So this is minus infinity to zero. Here you will be having zero onwards, and when you reach infinity, what has happened? So again, when you have reached infinity time, the infinity means a very long duration of the time, the transient phenomena will decay out and only the steady state will remain. Steady state remains means the inductor will be again short circuited and the capacitor will be open circuited. So three conditions you have to study, that is time t equal to 0 minus, time t equal to 0 plus, that is just after the switching instant, and time t equal to infinity means the steady state time when all the transients have been decayed out. So let us find what is happening at current 0 minus, okay, for this circuit, that is the before the switching. So before the switching, the current that is flowing in the network is basically the voltage, that is 12 volt, divided by the sum of the resistance, that is in series we have 4 plus 2, that is 6 ohms. So the current is equal to 2 ampere. Now what is happening to the voltage at time 0 minus? If you remember, we have made an assumption that the current will always be the inductor current and voltage will always be the capacitor voltage. So what is happening at 0 minus? Since the capacitor is open circuit and both capacitor and resistor are in parallel, so the voltage of the resistor, let us determine it at time 0 minus. So in accordance with Ohm's law, we have current multiplied with resistance. So we have 2 ohm multiplied with the current which is flowing at 0 minus. So we have 4 volt as the voltage. So we have done with I of 0 minus and V of 0 minus. Let us move to the next condition, or the circuit 2. So in the circuit 2, you can see that time t 0 plus, the inductor will not allow a sudden change in the current as it is a continuous process. Capacitor will not allow a sudden change in the voltage as it is a continuous process. So time t 0 plus and 0 minus, the condition remain the same for the inductor and the capacitor. Now the capacitor current, which is the same thing at 0 plus, is equal to 2 ampere. So the current that is flowing through the capacitor at 0 plus time is basically 2 ampere. Okay. Now what happened to the differentiation of the voltage at time t 0 plus? You know that capacitor current IC is equal to C dV by dt, right? From this we can find out what is dV by dt term, that is the current divided by the capacitance, and the time is 0 plus. So the capacitor current at 0 plus is 2 ampere and the capacitance value is 0.1 farad, which gives 20, and the unit is volt per second for dV plus 0 term. Now let us go to the other cases. Now time t equal to 0 plus for the network 2, if I apply the KVL equation, Kirchhoff's voltage law equation, that is algebraic sum of all the voltages in the loop to be 0, I can find the inductor voltage at time 0 plus, because the capacitor voltage we have already determined, the current we have already determined. This is a series network, so I can apply the KVL equation to find the voltage at time 0 plus. Okay, so I'll find the voltage at 0 plus is basically 0. Now I can apply the concept of inductor voltage, VL is equal to L di by dt, and try to find out the differentiation of the current di by dt at time 0 plus. Then I can find that the voltage 0 plus divided by inductor value will give me the current differential at time 0 plus. Inductor voltage is 0, so the differentiation of the current is 0, unit is ampere per second. Now the infinity time or the steady state time, I know that inductor will be short circuited and capacitor will be open circuited. So the figure 3 indicates that the current which is flowing is basically 0 ampere, because the current will not flow in the open circuit. The voltage in the capacitor will become 12 volt, because here the voltage will be 12 volt, which is equal to the source voltage. So in this way we can obtain the initial and the final values, and these values will be very important to find the boundary condition in the differential equation. Now let us jump to the RLC circuit, that is the second order circuit, you know that we have been discussing the circuit into two categories. One is known as the natural response or the source-free response, and second is basically the forced response, where we apply the external voltage source. Okay, now let us go for the natural response first, which is known as the source-free response. And RLC circuit that we are going to take is the series one, that is the series RLC circuit. We'll first discuss the series RLC circuit and then we'll move to the parallel RLC circuit. Let us take the series RLC circuit, which is the second order circuit, with the initial condition, because it is a source-free circuit, we require the initial voltage and the current present in the inductor and the capacitor. So the voltage which is present in the capacitor at time t equal to 0 is equal to V0, and the current which is present in the inductor at time t equal to 0 is I0. We have a series RLC network. Let us apply the KVL equation and try to find out what is happening. So once we apply the KVL equation in this particular circuit, which is a series RLC circuit, with all term of the inductor and capacitor to be in the differential integro-differential equation form. Now we are not interested in this equation because we need a pure differential equation. So we will be differentiating this equation to find a pure differential equation, and we observe that this equation, there is a two term appear, that is the order of the circuit, and hence the circuit is basically governed by a second order differential equation. So that is the reason we say the RLC network is a second order circuit or governed by the second order differential equation. This equation is very important for a series RLC network, and we have to remember this equation, which is written in the form d2x by dt square. I will write x because the variable can be current or voltage as we move to the other network. Plus we have some term which is R by L here. Please remember this R by L. Then we have dx by dt term. And then we have some constant which is equal to I by LC. Okay, so here you have x term. Now, how do the second order differential equation is solved, and what are the different conditions for that? This solution has a general form as the current is equal to Ae to the power st. Okay, the general form of this solution. On the right hand side, remember there is a zero term because it is a source free response. When we apply the forced response, some term will come here. This is only for a note, we are having zero term here. The solution has a general form I is equal to Ae to the power st. This you can find from any differential equation book, that is in mathematics, you can find the general solution. Now, what is the initial condition we require? Apart from this voltage and the current, some other initial conditions are required, which is the differential of the current and the differential of the voltage, right? So what happened is that if we apply the initial condition in the KVL equation for the series RLC network, that is R multiplied with current 0, L di by dt plus V0, because the initial voltage in the capacitor is V0, I can find the differential of the current at time t0. This equation is also very important because on numerical, when we are solving, we'll use this equation. Di by 0 by dt is equal to minus 1 by L R into I0 plus V0. So this equation need to be memorized. This equation need to be memorized. Now, if we substitute the current Ae to the power st in the second order differential equation, because this is the solution that we are having for the second order differential equation, if we substitute the value of the current and do the derivation wherever required for di by dt term, I will be having a form like this, where I have a term Ae to the power st multiplied with something differential, which is s square plus R by L into s plus 1 by LC is equal to 0. Now, since we are looking for I equal to Ae to the power st, the assumed solution we are trying to find, only the expression in the parenthesis can be 0. So these can be 0, these can't be 0 because this is the solution coming from the current. So when we make this expression s square plus R by L into s plus 1 by LC is equal to 0, that is basically known as the characteristic equation of the differential equation. You must have studied in the mathematics the second order differential equation, and these format. So s square plus r by l s plus 1 by lc is equal to 0 is the characteristic equation of the differential equation. The roots of these characteristic equation s1 and s2, which are the roots of these second order characteristic equation, is having a form where there is some plus sign and some minus sign is there. On the this part is remaining constant, minus r by 2l, and on the right hand side this equation is under root of r by 2l square minus 1 by lc. So these are the two roots which you can write in the form of plus minus. Now, can I write these two roots in a much better format? Let us see that. So in the compact form, if we are writing the roots s1 and s2, I will be having a term minus alpha plus minus under root alpha square minus omega naught square. It is required to remember this root form, where alpha is equal to r by 2l and omega naught is equal to 1 by under root of lc. There is some direct physical meaning of this alpha and omega naught in the root equation, which is the characteristic equation of the differential equation. Now let us see what are the roots. S1 and S2 are basically the roots of the characteristic equation, which are the natural frequencies. The unit is Nipper per second. The unit is Nipper per second because they are associated with the natural response of the circuit. If you remember, we have written a second order differential equation, and on the right hand side you have a zero term which is coming from the natural response, that is the source free response. So the roots that we are getting S1 and S2 are basically the natural frequencies. The unit is Nipper per second. What is omega naught? Omega naught is the resonant frequency. You know what is resonance. Resonance is the condition where the entire network impedance become equal to the resistance. Okay, and the XL value, that is the inductive reactance and capacitive reactance, is equal. Means the circuit is entirely resistive. So if you have a RLC circuit, then the XL and XC value will be equal and the circuit will become entirely the resistive. So the total impedance of the circuit will be resistive. So omega naught is related to the resonant frequency or the undamped natural frequency. There is another name. Generally we use resonant frequency, sometimes we use undamped natural frequency. So unit is radian per second for omega. Here the unit is Nipper per second. What is alpha? Alpha is basically the damping factor which is responsible for decaying out the oscillation. So whenever we have a transient oscillation, these oscillation will decay out from the transient to the steady state, which is governed by this alpha, known as the damping factor or the Nipper frequency. Unit is Nipper per second because this is the unit of the natural frequency only. Now, in terms of alpha and omega naught, our second order differential equation can be written in this format. S square plus r by l into s plus 1 by lc is equal to 0 is equal to s square plus 2 alpha s plus omega naught square is equal to 0. So the characteristic equation we have written as a function of alpha and omega naught, where alpha is the damping factor and omega naught is the resonant frequency of the system. The natural response of the series RLC circuit will have the response written in this format. So there will be two constant terms appearing, A1 and A2, and we have two roots, which is S1 and S2, that is giving us the exponential term e to the power s1t plus e to the power s2t. So this is the response of the series RLC network, which is the natural response. The constant A1 and A2 are basically determined using the initial values I of 0 and di of dt 0. Okay, we require to determine this constant A1 and A2, so that will be determined from the initial constant. Now, whenever we are having the response I of t in this format, there are different possibilities of the solutions. The solutions can be of three types. What are the types? Let us see. If alpha is greater than omega naught, I will be having the solution in the form of over damped case. Okay, because this is related to the damping factor. So alpha greater than omega naught will result in overdamped case. If alpha is equal to omega naught, then it will be resulting in critically damped case. If alpha is less than omega naught, it is underdamped case. So these three cases are very important for a series RLC network, which we will be finding when we solve some problem, that what type of solution will be there depending upon the case, that is overdamped, critically damped or underdamped system. Now let us first go for the overdamped case, then we move to the critically damped and then underdamped. So the general root is S1, S2, alpha and omega naught. We have seen how to find that. So if alpha is greater than omega naught in the overdamped case, if you can see that in the equation, the C will be greater than 4L by R square. This will come from the second order differential equation. You will see the capacitor value will be greater than 4L by R square. It means that the roots S1 and S2, that is the characteristic equation roots, are basically negative and real. You will have a real root, but it will be negative. So the response, which is written in this format, a1 e to the power s1t plus a2 e to the power s2t, as time will increase, the response will decay and approaches zero, means the transient part will die out. Now the response can be obtained as it is, because you will be having an expression where two constants are there, a1 and a2, and the equation is this. So for overdamped system, your response will be like this, where you have the current on the y-axis and on the x-axis you have the time. Let us move to the critically damped case now. For the critically damped case, which is alpha equal to omega naught, you will have the capacitor value equal to 4L by R square. In that case, the roots are equal. S1 and S2 roots will be equal, and it is equal to minus of alpha, which is equal to minus of R by 2L. So we have got the roots. Now the response, which is I of t, is equal to, in this format, these can be written in a3 e to the power at, where a3 is equal to a1 plus a2. Is the solution right? Now the question is, no, the solution is wrong. Now why the solution is wrong? Because the two initial conditions cannot be satisfied with the single constant a3. Here you see a1 and a2 are there, which I can't add to make a3. So it is the wrong solution that we have landed it. Until we go to the wrong solution, we will not find the right solution. So we will be in a search for what then could be wrong in this solution, which looks to be the correct, because we have two constant a1 and a2 and the roots s1 and s2 are equal. So I could think that I can add a3 is equal to a1 plus a2, and I could have made the solution in a much better format, a much easy format. But there is something wrong. What is wrong here? Let us try to look that. So when alpha is equal to omega naught is equal to R by 2L, the differential equation second order, d2i by dt square plus 2 alpha di by dt plus alpha square into current is equal to 0. This I can write it. Now I can write this equation in this format, okay, where d by dt term I can take out common, and I can write out in this format, in a much smaller format for this equation. If I consider this term to be f, then I will be having another differential equation in the form df by dt plus alpha f is equal to 0. So the solution for that f is equal to di by dt plus alpha I is equal to a1 e to the power minus alpha t, which is coming from the solution of f. Okay, so if I find the solution of this expression, I will getting this expression. On the LHS side, this part will remain constant, di by dt plus alpha I. On the right hand side, I will be having the solution for f. It means that if I take this term in this form, e to the power alpha t, that is multiplying on the LHS side and the RHS side with e to the power alpha t, and then find the differential and then integrate it, I will have a solution in this format, which is the correct solution for the critically damped case. So the solution that we understood to be correct is not correct, but when we recalculated everything right from the scratch, from the second order differential equation, I find the solution I is equal to A1T plus A2 e to the power minus alpha t. So you have to remember this solution for the critically damped case and the previous solution for the underdamped case. So the response for this current is in this manner, okay, where the response reaches a maximum value at a value 1 by alpha, and there is one time constant, and then it will decay out to 0. Okay, so we have a response of critically damped case in this manner, where the general expression of the current for the critically damped case is A1t plus A2 e to the power minus alpha t. So this is something linear, A1t, and here you have something which is the multiplication of time with e to the power minus alpha t and some linear term multiplied with this. Okay, so you have to remember this expression. Under damped case alpha less than omega naught, this case is the most used case, because day-to-day system which you will come across, any electrical system, 90% of the system will be under the category of under damped case. So alpha less than omega naught, the roots S1 and S2 will be complex now. Okay, we have seen the real root. Now for the underdamped case, the root will be complex, which can be written in the form of minus alpha plus j omega d minus alpha minus omega d. So we have plus minus sign on the this side, we have minus, and on the right hand side we have j omega d. What is omega d? Now a new term has come. Omega d is the damping frequency, which is under root of omega naught square minus alpha square, that we have taken from this side. So generally the system that you come across is under damped case. The general response to this case is basically in this manner. Okay, the solution for current I of t is equal to e to the power minus alpha t A1 e to the power j omega dt plus A2 e to the power minus j omega dt. Okay, so this is the general solution which you have to remember for the under damped case. Let us see this solution can be converted to trigonometric form or not, because this is in the exponential term. I have to convert this into trigonometric form. For this, I will be using the Euler's identity to make that to be in trigonometric form. E to the power j theta can be written as cos theta plus j sin theta, where e to the power minus j theta can be written as cos theta minus j sin theta. This is in accordance with Euler's identity that will be used to replace this exponential term into trigonometric form. So the new form that we can write for the current converting from the exponential to the trigonometric form is e to the power minus alpha t A1 plus A2. Here you have a cos function and here you have a sine function. Here you have a plus sign, here you have a minus sign. And then J term indicates that it is a complex term of the current. If I replace this A1 plus A2, both constant, with a single constant B1 and A1 minus A2 constant as B2, I will have a much better format to write this equation. So e to the power minus alpha t B1 cos of omega dt plus B2 sine of omega dt. So we have a cosine expression, sine expression, as well as the exponential expression we have. Presence of sine and cosine function, so if you can see there is a sine function and cosine function, makes the natural response exponentially damped and oscillatory. So the nature of these underdetermined, underdamped system is basically damped as well as oscillatory in nature. So there will be some oscillations in nature. Time constant is 1 by alpha, which we have seen in the critically damped case also, and the time period will be 2 pi by omega t. So if I draw this response of underdamped case of this current, we have a cosine and sine function, so it will be damped and oscillatory and exponential. Okay, so it will be exponentially damping and oscillatory in nature with a period of t equal to 2 pi by omega d, and this is the nature of underdamped system. What are the peculiar properties of the RLC network that we have studied now? Okay, let us summarize the peculiar properties of the RLC network. The behavior of this network is basically decided due to the damping phenomena. which is basically the gradual loss of initial stored energy that is present in the inductor or capacitor and represented by decrease in response amplitude. In all the three responses that we have seen, whether the system is overdamped, underdamped, or critically damped, the response is dying out just because there is some damping. If damping is not there, then the response will not decay out. This damping effect is due to the resistance which is present in the system. If the resistance is not present, damping will not take place. And alpha, which is the damping factor, determine the rate at which the damping will take place, means how fast the system will go from the transient phenomena to the steady state phenomena is decided by this alpha, which is the damping factor. If the circuit is lossless, means the resistance is zero, what will happen? Alpha will become zero, and in that case, the LC circuit will never be losing its energy and it will resonate with a frequency omega naught equal to 1 by under root of LC. Okay, the damping is not there, so the system will not die out and it will be constantly oscillating with omega naught equal to 1 by under root LC. So alpha less than omega naught, which we have studied the case, the response is undamped and oscillatory. If you adjust this resistance, so always some resistance will be there in the passive network. If you adjust that resistance, you can control the system from under undamped case, overdamped case, critically damped case, or underdamped case. You can control anything in the system. So their LC network is basically the undamped case. Okay. So you should have some resistance in the network which will control the value of alpha, and then you can make the system to be any wish you want. Due to the presence of two types of storage element, oscillatory response is possible with flow of energy back and forth between the two. So you have inductor and a capacitor, both are storing energy in the electric field and the magnetic field. So this stored in the magnetic field, this stored in the electric field. So there is continuous flow of the energy between the two, and the resistance is resulting in the decaying out of the amplitude of the energy. So there is something called ringing. What is ringing? The damped oscillation exhibited by the underdamped response is known as ringing. So one term we have given to understand the damping phenomena in the underdamped case, that is known as ringing. Critically damped case that we have studied decays fastest. So the fastest conversion of the transient to the steady state is basically due for the critically damped case, which is the borderline, means the center of the response between the underdamped and the overdamped case. So the fastest is basically the critically damped. The sluggish is basically, we can say, the overdamped case, and underdamped case is the other end. Overdamped case has the longest settling time. So overdamped case, when we have the longest settling time, means the time taken to dissipate the initial energy is the very large for the overdamped case. Critically response is the best choice. So when we try to design a system, it is the best choice to let the response settle fastest without oscillation and ringing. If you do not want any oscillation or ringing and you want the system to be very fast, that is transient decay out, the critically response is the best choice. We'll solve one problem to understand this second order series RLC network. Question is, determine the current I of t assuming the circuit has reached steady state at time t 0 minus. Okay, the time t 0 minus, the circuit has reached to the steady state. So this is my circuit where a switch is connected and switching action is taking place. What has happened to the current at time 0 minus, which is the steady state time? So let us see at different time instant what is happening. For time t less than 0, what is happening? Time t less than 0, the switch is basically closed. Okay, because switch is open at time t equal to 0. Time t less than 0, the switch is closed. Capacitor, you know, it will be open circuit because it has reached to the steady state for a long time. Inductor will be short circuited, and I will get a new circuit for time t less than 0, where, so this is the first circuit for time t less than 0. Capacitor is open circuit and inductor is short circuited. Okay, so if I get in this circuit, can I find the initial condition for this circuit of the current and the voltage? So in this circuit, time t less than 0, let us find the current. So current is basically the voltage divided by the total resistance. We have 4 plus 6, that is 10 ohm. 1 ampere is the current which is flowing. What is the voltage of the capacitor? So here you have the voltage, which is same as the voltage across the 6 ohm resistor. Okay, so you will be getting the voltage as 6 into I of 0, which is equal to 6 volt in accordance with Ohm's law. Now this is the second case, that is for t greater than 0, when the switch has opened. When the switch has opened, the circuit to the left will be disconnected and you will be getting a new circuit. If you closely observe this circuit, what has happened? The circuit is basically a source-free series RLC network. With the initial voltage present in the capacitor, because the capacitor will not allow a sudden change in the voltage, and the voltage will be as it is when the switching has taken place. Now, since it is a RLC network second order circuit, I know I have to first calculate the value of alpha, which is equal to R by 2L. So depending upon the resistance and the inductance value, you calculate alpha, you will get 9. Then I will calculate omega naught frequency term, 1 by under root LC, that is equal to 10. Now alpha and omega naught is calculated from the parameters that are there defining the network. I can find the roots of this characteristic equation, which is equal to minus alpha plus minus under root alpha square minus omega naught square. I find that the root is complex, minus n plus minus j 4.3599, which is the root of the characteristic equation. So I have to decide what type of system is this. Since alpha is less than omega, the system is underdamped. So from the root, I can decide what is the system. It is underdamped system because alpha is less than omega. So the general solution of current I of t, I know e to the power minus alpha t a1 cos of omega d into t plus a2 sine of omega d into t. So this is the general, because here you have the alpha term, here you have the omega d term, which you have to substitute in the current equation. Now the time is there to calculate the constant a1 and a2. Let us first determine the constant a1. So substitute the value of the time to be 0, you will get the a1 is equal to 1. Now di by dt at time t equal to 0, I have told you to remember this equation when the derivation was there, minus L R of I0 plus V0. So this is the initial current I0, this is the initial voltage V0. This expression will give me the differential of the current at time t equal to 0, which is equal to minus 6 ampere per second. Now, the current equation I have got, I can differentiate this current di by dt and I will be having in this format. Okay, I have not put the value of a1 anything, where a1 is 1 only, but I have not substituted, I have differentiated it. Now, if I substitute the value of the a1, that is equal to 1, I can find out what is a2, because di by dt term, I know it is minus 6, which I can put it here in the di by dt term. So I will get the value of a2. A1, I have already got it. Now my final solution of the current, that is for a second order system, RLC network, e to the power minus alpha t, where alpha is equal to 9, cos of omega d into t, where omega d is equal to 4.359, the constant a1 is 1 and the constant a2 is 0.6882 sine of omega d into t ampere is the general solution for the current for this circuit. So we have discussed the series RLC network and we have covered the natural response. In the next topic, we will focus on the parallel RLC network and then we'll move to the forced response.